these words. And good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to have a session with you all, the reserve scholars from various parts of the state as well as the country. And to begin with, I would like to extend my profound thanks to the management, Honorable Vice Chancellor, esteemed Registrar, respected Dean, School of Social Sciences and Humanities, and the conveners of this STTP, Dr. H. Sophia, Professor in Head, Department of English, BSA Crescent, and Dr. S. Vijay Kumar, Assistant Professor of English, BSA Crescent, for having given me this wonderful opportunity to deliberate on this topic that is one of the most essentials of research, that is understanding search and research. Search. Any research should begin with search. In fact, searching is the primary as well as the principal skill needed for a researcher. But at the same time, it is the most time-consuming, challenging, physically and mentally exhausting, and to be precise, the most mind-boggling activity in the research. As a result, I would say that it is the most compromised activity by a researcher. However, if the search is meticulously planned and executed, if it is systematically done, definitely it will yield amazing results. And it will even transcend your research to newer dimensions and extreme heights that you have never expected. If you meticulously plan your research, you will come across pleasant discoveries and serendipities that will make this process truly enjoyable and exciting experience. So the objective of this session is to make this labyrinthine process, search process, less complicated and simpler, and to make the research scholars to do an effective research. So with this introduction, let's go into the session. I will share my screen. Hope that this is visible. Hope I'm audible also. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
So, understanding search and research. So before getting into the details, let's have a glimpse of the topics we are going to deal in this session. So we are going to see what is literature search and also the steps involved in the process of searching. That is defining your search, decide where to search, develop a search strategy, refine your search strategy, and how to save your search for future use. In addition to this process, I will also give you some useful links for some certain resources, useful resources as a supplement for your research process. So let's get into the topic. What is literature searching? It's not just Googling. It's not just blindly searching or searching at random or following wherever Google takes us. What is it then? It's a considered and organized search to find key literature on a topic. So searching for key literature on a topic, according to Chris Fuller, he sees this as a twofold process. Number one, it not only helps you understand what sources and evidences that already exist related to your topic, your chosen topic. At the same time, the accuracy needed for an effective search makes it imperative that you need to narrow down your title. In fact, I would call this a prerequisite for doing this literature searching. That is, narrowing down your title and making it more specific is a prerequisite for beginning your search. As the previous speaker insisted on how to narrow down your title before getting into the design and all. So I would call this as a first step. So effective literature search involves the following steps, as we had already seen in the overview. What are the steps? You have to define what you're going to search for, and you need to decide where to search. Okay. And for effective searching, you need to develop a search strategy. And in order to make it more effective, you need to refine your search strategy, and you need to save your search for future use. So we are going to see these steps one by one. So defining your search, the first step. Definitely, the beginners, the research scholars at the initial stage will have lots of confusions, like where to begin, how to proceed, like Robert Frost, like which road to take. More than Robert Frost, you will have more questions, more avenues to search for. Definitely, you have lots of confusion. So this exploring the search terms will help you to narrow down your title. So I'll give you an example, like how to explore your search terms. Suppose you have interest in doing like the impacts of technology on ELT, right? So you have that interest to pursue research in this topic. So you just write a broad question. You frame a question like this: what impact has technology had on ELT in ESL context? So if you see this question, it is too broad and vague for any good academic research. It is too broad. But at the same time, it's not a bad topic or a bad beginning. It's a good beginning, Mali. You have written down the key terms: technology, ELT, and ESL context. So the next step is you need to narrow it down. You have to make it more focused and something that is measurable. So because academic researchers knowing about so many things, lots of things about a little, and it is not vice versa, right? In other words, it's a vertical knowledge, not horizontal. So having these two important criteria in mind, the time limit, the time duration for doing your research, and then the word count for writing your research, right? So based on these two important criteria, you need to narrow down your title. So how to narrow it down? Okay, that's what we are going to see step by step. So now in this topic, if you had seen, I had highlighted three key terms. Okay, now we are going to explore these terms one by one, right? So first, let's take technology. So technology is the first key term I have highlighted. See how I'm breaking it into, how I'm exploring into different types of technology. I have just broadly classified under the umbrella terms. Technology, lots of words are there, like call is there, and then like web to technology. So many different words you have under this. So I have broadly classified under these terms: multimedia technology, web tools, and LMS, educational technology, interactive online platforms for teaching and learning English. Okay, so LMS there, and then we have our smartphones. So I have broadly classified, and further you can explore these terms. For example, multimedia, you can further explore it into audiovisual, TV or podcast, whatever you can bring it under the term, for example. And then web tools, you can further explore it into like blogs, YouTube, Flickr, wikis, and all those things, like mobile phones, how we are going to use mobile phones. Similarly, you can further explore these terms and come out with lots of key terms related to it. And next, let's take ELT. So next key term is ELT. So English language teaching. So it is English language. I have just explored it into four skills: listening, speaking, reading, and writing, and then grammar, vocabulary. Of course, you can also include pronunciation. And since it is teaching, so I have also included pedagogy there. Hope this screen is visible. The teaching, I have included different types of pedagogy. So each term I have further exploded. So similarly, you can explore it till you get almost all that, till it is comprehensive. Okay, actually what I have presented is not exhaustive, so I have given roughly what are the things to give you an idea. Okay, how to explore the terms I have given you. So you can focus on sub skills, and if you take speaking, you can take about presentation skills, discussion skills, or fluency, or you can even bring pronunciation here. Okay, and the sub skills on reading, okay, you can focus on. So likewise, you can further explore these terms. Okay? And pedagogy, if you take it, flipped pedagogy, blended pedagogy, and CLT, and you have lots of acronyms related to that, so you can take anything. Whichever is your field of choice of interest, you can take it. And then next key term, if you take ESL context I have given, so if you further explore this in the primary level, secondary level, tertiary level, urban, semi-urban, rural, you can take. So further you can, primary also you can further explore, secondary also you can further explore. Like I have explored this tertiary level, like different types of learners, engineering, commerce, science, likewise you can do it. Okay, so this is just an example. In the ELT context, the same thing you can do with literature also. broadly you frame a question, okay, and identify the key terms, and for each key term you just break it into parts, okay, explore your search terms, right? Of course, you need to have a background knowledge about it. Of course, you can Google also for exploring initially, right? So after exploring the search terms, I have modified my broad and vague title like this: what impact has mobile apps? So instead of technology, I have shortlisted, I have narrowed it down to mobile apps, okay? Then had on enhancing the writing skills of the engineering students at the UG level, right? This is just an example. So you can substitute this mobile apps with any other particular technology tools, okay? What impact has blogs on enhancing the report writing skills of, you understand? So you can make it more specific, the argumentative writing of the engineering students, or you can focus on the secondary level students or the commerce students or the business students. At the UG level it is given, you can make it more specific, like this area, this particular type of a student, this collegiate level, this university level students. Likewise, you can make it more and more specific. Okay, so this exploring your search terms is a useful way of narrowing down your title. So all the researchers at the initial stage, you can do it very easily, like a mind map. You can prepare a concept map, okay, and even tools are available for doing this. And if you go to Microsoft store, you can have some tools to make this mind map or concept map. You can use it, or you can even do it manually, okay? So these specific terms, suppose you just see the words highlighted there: mobile apps, enhancing the writing skills, engineering students, okay? So you have made it more specific. This enables you for more accurate search. So this particular question, what I have zeroed in on, it allows you to experiment with different combinations, right? So mobile apps, you can experiment with something else, some other technology tools or some other skills or some other component of language. So different combinations you can experiment with. As a result of it, you will definitely come out with innovative and unexpected, interesting titles, okay, with a good scope for research. Okay, so it's better you begin with a broad and vague title, you write it down, but you do a systematic explosion of search terms. So that is the first step in our searching process. Now we have defined what to search for, the first step. Okay, what to search for? We have highlighted the key concepts, the search terms in the question. Now we will go to the second step. So second step is decide where to search. Definitely searching is synonymous with Google nowadays, right? For everything, anything and everything, we just Google. Okay, it's quite natural. And internet, right, it's a powerful research tool, but at the same time it poses considerable risks and challenges for the uncritical researcher. Okay, what are the challenges? The freedom to publish and share materials by anybody, okay, have made the internet a huge repository of data, volumes of data available, and of course good data also, resourceful materials also available, freely accessible educational resources, think tank papers, government reports, speeches, whatnot. You have everything available on the internet, but at the same time, okay, the challenge is like anybody can publish, anybody can share. Okay, so makes content unreliable. Okay, you cannot always rely on the internet resources. It may be accidentally incorrect or deliberately incorrect. Okay, misleading materials will be there, biased materials will be there, especially when taking sensitive topics like politics and religion and all. You have to be extremely careful whether the materials are reliable, authentic and genuine. So this overabundance of resources is a blessing as well as a pain. Okay, so you have to be more critical, more evaluative, more interpretative, and you need to use your discretion to use the data from the internet, right? So whatever we have seen today is applicable to Wikipedia. It's a good place to start searching. Wikipedia is a good place to start searching. It's free to access, of course, incredibly informative and extremely useful. You have the data, but at the same time, it cannot be reliable all the time, because anybody can edit, anybody can change, alter the data. So you have to be very careful. You need to, instead of taking the content directly from the Wikipedia, you have to go back to the citation, that is references, and check the origins of the information. And not only that, you need to evaluate. You need to evaluate the content using your discretion, right? So next, Google Scholar. It is better than standard Google. So what it does actually, it filters your search. Filters your search and then take the resources from various academic that is repositories, right, and the professional societies related to academia and online repositories of scholarly literature are available. So Google Scholar, to begin with, these are all good. Okay, it's not a bad place to start searching. These are all good to begin with. And like a directory of open access journals, it is also an online directory with curated list of like journals and articles. Okay, increasingly large number of journals openly available, free to access. Okay, so you can make, you can start your searching in these places initially. Okay, initially it is good to start your search. Okay, and it is not enough. Okay, only these places are not enough. So which is the better place? Okay, better than these. Okay, which is a better place to search, and you have this databases. Okay, so subject specific databases are the most effective way to search for journal articles on a topic. So these databases, it's a huge repository actually, and lots of peer reviewed academic articles, not only from a particular location or region, all over the world from different publishers and over a longer time period. Okay, it's a huge repository, that's the word, right? So these databases have expansive records of research literature, including conference proceedings, letters, and grey literature. Grey literature is the literature which is not produced by academia. It is non-academia produced literature, like government reports and business organizations reports and all those things. The data given by the business organizations, that is grey literature. So you have a comprehensive, okay, sources available in these databases, right? So among the most popular databases, right, I have shortlisted only the databases which are relevant to language and literature, right? Web of Science, the Scopus, and Oxford Reference Online, right, ProQuest, or these databases which are relevant to language and literature. Okay, so you can resort to this for better search, okay, better search on your topic, and how to use these databases. So databases, each database works differently. You have to have this in mind always. Each database works differently. So it's better having chosen to search in Web of Science, okay, it's better you need to first go to the help or the guide or the support given in the database section, right? So you need to understand what are the strategies, what you need to develop, what are the things, do's and don'ts while searching. Okay, so only then you will get a better understanding of how to get the best results from your search. Okay, so first start with the support section. Once you enter into the database, you start from the support section. Okay, so there are different types of searching available. We are going to see next. Okay, what are the different kinds of searching on the search strategy? So you can search for articles using keywords, authors, and subjects. Okay, and the databases will provide a list of results, and each result will have an abstract and publication details based on which you can decide whether to read the full text or not. Okay, so you will be able to read the abstract, and based on that you can decide whether it is useful or not. Okay, so now having a decided way to search, okay, now we will go for the search strategy. Okay, so what is the search strategy? It is an organized structure of key terms used to search a database. Okay, so key terms we have already identified, right? So while framing the question, we have already identified the key terms. So how to use these key terms, in which order, I mean its structure, okay, that makes a lot of difference. Okay, the position of the words, right? Where do you place? What is the word you place? Everything matters while searching in order to get accurate results, right? So it combines the key concepts of your search question in order to retrieve accurate results, okay? The combination of your concepts, for example, what we had seen in the question, right? What we had zeroed in on, like mobile apps for enhancing the writing skills of the engineering students at the UG level. So these are the key concepts of your search question. So how do you combine, okay? In what order? That makes a lot of difference, okay? So again, you have to keep in mind each database works differently. So depending on the working procedure, okay, the operating procedure, you need to adapt your search strategy for each database. For example, what works in Web of Science may not work in Scopus. Okay, a little bit of difference, not like a huge diversions and all, and like little bit of differences. More or less, they are function the same manner, but the symbols and the criteria they use for searching may differ. Right. So after going through this search, after seeing your results, it is very important to refine your search. Okay, depending on the results you get, whether you get more number of relevant results or more number of irrelevant results. So based on that, you need to test your strategies and you have to refine them. Okay, and we are going to see the search strategy, what are the different kinds of strategy you need to adopt at all. So roughly 7 steps are there. Okay, so you need to understand it. So first step, how to develop your search strategy is choosing the search terms. You can ask, already we have chosen the search terms, already we have identified the key concepts and all, but the problem is concepts can be expressed in different ways. Okay, how do you express will be different from the other researcher, right? And moreover, English is a language which is rich in vocabulary. So lots of synonyms will be available. For example, I have told you, like speaking can be referred to as it's oral also, right? So you need to search both using these key terms, speaking as well as oral, right? Some of the researchers would have mentioned it as oral skills, right? So likewise, you need to choose the search terms, alternative keywords you need to search for each key term you have identified. Okay, so that's what given, right? Consider each of your concepts and come up with a list of different ways they could be expressed. Okay, so each concept, how it can be expressed in different ways. For example, UG students I have given. So it can be expressed as at the collegiate level, at the university level, at the tertiary level. Right, so you need to know how it can be expressed in different ways. You can ask like, how do I know? We know only 2 or 3 synonyms and all. What are the best ways to get the alternative keywords, right? So you can use a thesaurus. So what are the steps? You can use a thesaurus to identify the synonyms. For example, like speaking, how different ways it can be interpreted, right? And so search for your concepts on a search engine like Google Scholar, scanning the results for alternative words and phrases. You just type mobile apps for language teaching, you will get thousands of results. You just have a glance on the first page itself, you will understand what are the variety of terms, the articles, the researchers have used to convey that idea. Okay, so mobile apps, it can be used like a MAL, mobile assisted language learning, or YAM learning, right? So there are different ways of using the terms by different researchers. So you can make a list of the alternative words and phrases, right? You make a list. You have to do it consciously. You have to do it systematically, right? And examine this, that is one way. And another way is you get the abstracts, right? You get some 10 abstracts, or 15 abstracts, 100 abstracts. You just go through the abstracts and articles for alternative words, phrases, and subject headings. Subject headings, of course, I will tell you what in the after 2 to 3 slides, we are going to see that, okay? You need to, or you can get easily the alternative words, phrases, and subject headings, okay? So as you search and scan articles and abstracts, definitely you will come across lots of key terms, alternative key terms to enhance your search strategy, okay? So you can go one by one doing it systematically. Okay, now you have listed out lots of alternative keywords for searching, right? So next, what you have to do, you can search with keywords. You can search with keywords. Definitely you would have seen keywords, or you have written also one while submitting articles for publication. Okay, what are keywords? They are free text words and phrases used in an article. Okay, so a keyword search usually looks for your search terms in the title and abstract of a reference. So suppose you use the keywords and then search only in the title and abstract, the search engine searches and then gives you the results, right? So another important point you need to keep in mind is there is no autocorrect option in some of the databases, right? So what you need to do is you have to be really careful while using the right spelling. Okay, even if you, even if there is a typo, or even if you make inadvertent error, right? So the spelling is wrong, it will not give you correct results. You will miss lots of references. So databases, they don't have autocorrect facility. Okay, so you need to be careful with your spelling in writing the spelling. Of course, we have our discrepancies in American English and then British English. Okay, all those things are also sorted out by means of these databases. We will see it next, right? So you need to use correct spelling while searching the keywords and phrases. Okay, when you search using keywords, the search that is terms in the title and abstract of the reference are given. Okay, so next we will go for searching with exact phrase. So this exact phrase, instead of just one word keyword, now you are going to search with exact phrases, right? So you have to use quotation marks. Quotation marks while searching for phrase. Like online tools, identity crisis. Okay, so if you give within quotation marks, the results will be like the words, okay, the articles which uses, articles or the titles which uses these phrases together. Okay, so you may get, or you will get more relevant results if you use phrase searching, right? Keyword searching, you will have more number of results. Phrase searching, the results will be less, but it will be more relevant, right? So most databases allow you to search for phrases, but okay, as we had already seen that each database is unique, it operates differently. So you need to understand the database before searching for, searching with exact phrases, right? And next to two strategies, okay, we are going to see to make your search more advanced, okay, more refined, more specific rather than that. So truncation and wildcard searches. What are these things? Okay, and truncated and wildcard searches. To find variations of your search term, it's very simple. Don't get taken aback by the words and all. It's very simple. What is this truncation and wildcard? So truncation is useful for finding singular and plural forms. As we had already seen, databases are very much particular about appropriate spelling. Even like a speaker, speakers, it makes lots of difference. For speaker, you will have 100 results. Speakers, you will have 150 results. Okay, for example, right? So even singular and plural forms of words and variant endings makes lots of difference in your search result. Okay, and how to search this truncation and all? Many databases use an asterisk, the symbol. Okay, so even this symbol will differ from one database to another database. Some database will use asterisk, some will use question mark, some will use hashtag. Okay, so you need to understand what symbol is used for asterisk. Of course, it's given in the help page or the support page of the database, right? So as the truncation symbol. So check the database help section if you are not sure which symbol to use. It is there already available, right? So for example, I have given like oppress is the base word. And if you use the asterisk and then check it, you will find oppression, oppressive, oppressor, oppressors. Okay, four different words you get, and the four different words, again, it makes changes in your search results. Okay, for example, if you give just oppression without this asterisk symbol, you will get results only which use this word oppression, right? Suppose you use asterisk oppress, you will get results with all these words related. So that makes definitely an enormous difference. Okay. So truncation and wildcard search. What is this wildcard? A wildcard finds variant spellings of words. We have this UK and US variation in the spelling. So even that, suppose you use behavior, B-E-H-A-V-I-O-U-R, right? You will get very less results. Suppose you use a question mark in between and then search, you will get more results. Okay. That is articles which use both O-U-R and O-R. So even just one letter, one character makes a difference in your searching. Okay. So a wildcard finds variant spellings of words. So again, you need to go to the help section of the database to see which symbol to use as a wildcard. So in Medline database, Medline, of course, it's not related to us. Okay. But I'm giving an example. So in Medline database, they use question mark, right? There will be different symbols. So if you go for Scopus or Web of Science or related to what I brought question, you just see which symbol is used to find the wildcard search. Okay. And see here, in Medline database, for this alternative spelling, woman, that is plural form. In plural form, you know English, right? Lots of that is discrepancies, right? In the spelling, in the plural form and everything. So woman and women, right? If you use just woman, okay, it will give articles only with the keyword woman. Suppose you use the hashtag again, it will give articles with both woman and women. Okay, so these are the benefits of truncation and wildcard searching. And next is adjacency searching. Adjacency searching or proximity searching also it can be called. Okay, so what is this adjacency searching? From the very word you can understand, like you can specify how close two words appear together, right? For example, mobile apps and language teaching, you are using this. And in many titles, mobile apps and language teaching that may not be together, it may be in the fourth position, fifth position or sixth position, likewise in the title, right? So this adjacency searching helps you to get results more relevant. Okay. Generally, this criteria is closer two words appear to each other, the closer the relationship is between them. Right. So you can do this adjacency searching in case if you don't have relevant results. Right. If you want more relevant results, you can use this adjacency searching or proximity searching. Even these terms are different in the databases. Okay. So you can learn it once you go to the help section. So comments for adjacency searching differ among databases, as we had already seen. And the example I have given you, Web of Science, it is near a slash and X. Okay. And that is in the place of X, you can write 2, 3, 4, likewise the word order, right? So suppose you write near slash 3 means it will fetch you results that mobile phones and language learning that is three words ahead. Okay, in between mobile phones and language learning, there are three words. You understand? So you can use this adjacency searching in case if your results are not that much effective or useful, right? And next comes searching with subject headings. Already we have seen subject headings. What's the difference between keywords and subject headings? Subject headings are controlled vocabulary terms. Controlled vocabulary terms means each database, okay, describes certain headings under a broad umbrella term. Okay, for example, you can see mobile apps in the key terms, okay, keywords, but you cannot see that under the subject heading. Subject headings are broader terms, umbrella terms. It may be under technology, integrated language teaching, or just language teaching, or technology in language teaching. It can be different, okay? It differs from one database to another database, right? So the subject headings will give you more results, okay? More results, because it's an umbrella term, it will give you lots of results, okay? So this enhances your search, in fact, appropriate subject headings. How do I know the subject headings, you can ask? It is there given in the database itself. Okay, so it's not a big deal to find out what is the subject heading. Okay, they will give you a list of subject headings, and you have to just click, okay, what subject heading you need to use it. Okay, so to have better results, you can combine both subject headings and keywords also. Okay, for each of the concepts you identify, suppose you identify some four concepts in your title, right? So for each of the concepts, you can combine the subject headings and keywords. So this will give you more results, right? So as we had already seen, this varies from database to another database. These are all database specific. Okay. And Boolean logic. What is this Boolean logic? These are nothing but simple words, conjunctions, okay, which are used to combine or exclude, okay, certain search terms. Okay, so it's again, it will make your search more effective. Okay, and or not, and not. Okay, these are all Boolean operators. So this will help you to type different combinations of search terms or subject headings. For example, you can write oral or oral skills. Okay, so if you type like oral or oral skills, you will get either this or that. Right, either of the topics you search for, you will get that result. Suppose you use oral and oral skills. Okay, so you will get articles that mention both of the searched topics. You got it? So each definitely makes a difference. You need to experiment to understand why I'm repeating that it makes a difference. It makes a difference. Suppose you just go to Google Scholar and type, for each word, the results will differ. For some, it will be getting 1,000 results. Okay, suppose you remove just one word, it will be reduced to 7 related articles. Okay, so it makes a huge difference. Okay, even one single Boolean logic, okay, or one single key term, whatever you use, it means even one single character, as we have seen, a question mark as a hashtag and all. Okay, so databases and all, how to use these Boolean operators, you can ask. It is given there as a button or a drop down menu. You can click and then you can combine your search terms or results, or as we had already seen, these are all database specific, how we can use and all. It is given in the help section, but do understand that these Boolean operators helps you get more refined or relevant articles for your topic. Okay, and citation searching. Citation searching, actually, you can find articles that have been cited by other publications. Okay, so when you get the articles, when you get the results, you need to know how far these articles, okay, are cited by other authors, how far they are authentic, how far they are reliable, how far, okay, they have been used, right? How far it has been evolved over the years, right? You can understand all these things in the citation searching, right? So you can find out whether articles have been cited by other authors. Suppose there won't be any citation, you can understand that it is very new or yet to be cited, or depending on the year, okay, when it is published, when it is cited and all, you can understand the kind of impact made by the research. Okay, so you can get some ideas by using the citation searching. That will also help you get the more recent papers on the similar subject. Okay, so that will lead to you, that citation searching will lead you to more recent papers. Suppose you are referring to some 2010 article, it is cited by some 150 citations are there. If you go into the citations, you will get to know what is the most recent paper on that. So you can get the idea. You can see the evolution of ideas, how the known idea or innovation has been confirmed, applied, improved, extended, or corrected. So you can understand the evolution of ideas easily. Okay, so this makes your literature review more comprehensive, this citation searching. And you have the cited reference searching in Google Scholar, Web of Science, and Scopus, right? So this actually complement your literature search. Okay, the citation searching, without which your literature search will not be complete, because you are able to get the most recent research, okay, on the topic chosen by means of this citation searching. Okay, now we have seen the first three steps. Okay, we have developed a search strategy and you have got some results now. Okay, just one search in the database, you will get umpteen number of results, right? You will get n number of results you will get. Okay, not all the results will be accurate. Not all the results will be relevant for your topic. Most of the results may be inaccurate or not inaccurate, may be irrelevant. Okay, it may be irrelevant for you. So you need to make your search more effective. Okay, that is refine your search. And in the databases, otherwise even Google Scholar itself, you would have seen advanced search options and all, right? In any, even the journals and all, you can go and see advanced search and options for that. So more or less the same in the databases. Okay, how to refine your search based on the results you have got. Okay, you can even widen your search or limit your search. You can widen your search or restrict your search based on the number of results, relevant or irrelevant, you get. Understand? So suppose you get very few results, okay, very few references which are relevant. Okay, you didn't get much references, okay, after your search. So what you can do, okay? So consider this steps, right? You can check your spelling, as we had already seen. They will not autocorrect, so you have to check your spelling, okay? Or in case of necessity, you can use this truncated and while searching and all, okay? Using the symbols for extending your search, right? And you check your search question also. For example, mobile apps only you are using. Okay, make it broader, like mobile phones. Right? So use a broader search question. For example, tertiary level alone you have seen. So extend it to generally learning. Okay, don't just specify it to the tertiary level, generally language teaching or generally language learning. Okay, so use a broader search question. Okay, and if you had chosen just one or two, you can search for more databases. Okay, so each database have a wide variety and a different list of articles, right? So could you add more search terms? You think over it, right? You just reflect upon it and look for variations. As I had told you, while the called truncated searching, you can do that, and alternative words you can look out for. You can discuss your topic with your supervisor, okay, to make it more broad and more searchable, right? And you can also restrict your search. Restrict, suppose you get more results, too many results you have got, okay, that you cannot manage, 4,000, 7,000 also there. You just go to the search engines, databases, you will get so many results, okay? So too many results you have got, so what you have to do, you just do it. Focus your search. Make it more specific and check your searching strategy. Okay, whether you have used AND instead of R. R means the results will be less. AND means it will be more. So what you have done? Okay, you just check your searching. Okay, and you can also limit it by date range. For example, like since 2010, you can use it. Okay. In all the databases, you have these limitations. You have how to limit and all, there are options available. Or since 2000 or only 2020. Okay. Likewise, you can, depending on, okay, you can limit it by date range. And also you can limit the search by region or country specifically if your results are more. You can even limit the language. Okay. Some research language research papers will be in different languages also, Spanish, Chinese and all, right? So you can restrict it to only to English, right? That can also be done. And another two important things to refine your search are search limits and search filters, okay? Search limits and search filters. So each database offers a different range of limits. So this is also database specific, okay? So publication year, language and publication type, that you can limited, and these options are available in the database itself, right? So depending on the results you get, you can use the limits or filters. Okay, filters you would have seen definitely, like search filters, they are all pre-tested strategies. You need not do anything, the filters will be there available already. So going through the filters, you can just click whichever is relevant for your search, okay, to identify the specific literature. These filters are available, useful, right? So it can be used to restrict your search. So databases help section will give you how to filter, how to limit your searches and all. These are all database specific. So what works in one database will not work in other databases. So as we had seen in the beginning, it is better to start with the help section of each database. Okay. And so we have tried all the options, but still, okay, we cannot guarantee that all the databases are 100% perfect in giving you all the results, entire results. Okay. Not all the items may be indexed, or it may be improperly indexed, right? So you may not get enough results because of all those things. And from your side also, you would have made some mistakes in the search. All these are possible, right? However, we have the huge repositories. Okay. So best way, or one of the ways to refine your search, is search by hand. Okay, suppose you come across a book. So you just go to the book, okay, and then see what is the content, the chapters and everything else. If you come across some useful materials that you can make use of, right? So hand searching, right? You can use it manually or electronically, online itself, okay? Suppose some books are given, okay, relevant to your topic, you can go through it and then identify the chapters or the topics which are relevant for your search, okay, relevant for your topic. So it involves selecting key journals in your subject area, searching each one, going to the index, okay, going to the table of contents, okay, the TOC, journal TOC page, and individually and search the articles, okay, whichever is relevant for your topic. So now we have seen the fourth step, that is refining your search, and the most important this criteria, the step involved in searching process is saving your search. So you have to see the title carefully. It is not saving the articles or resources. Of course, that is a part of it, but this is saving your search. Okay, so you can save your search strategy. Okay, in fact, I'll tell you, like there are research log you can use. Okay, otherwise search activity template. Okay, it is available. So you can use the search activity template to write down the search, okay, the history of your search, each search, okay. This is what I call systematic searching, right? So you can save copies of the useful records you find, and where possible, save a copy of your search strategy, okay. You are saving a copy of your search strategy. Why? Because you need not have to repeat the work, right? Once again, because this process is not just a one-day process, it's a long process, this searching process. Okay, so you will definitely forget about a history of search. Okay, so you have to save your strategy. Okay, so another thing, you need to save the articles you find, the useful relevant materials, relevant resources you come across, that also you need to save it. Okay, of course, databases, they allow you to save or print the article, and you can either save as a text file or an RIS file, okay, research information system, that is, and print or email that, okay. So these options are given by the databases, or you have this reference software, you can directly export also to this EndNote. These are all the options given by the databases. Usually databases will not allow you to download the full text and all, but they will give you the links. Okay, but if your library subscribes those databases, those journals, you can download the full text articles. Okay, so it depends again on the database. Okay, and as we had already seen, save your search strategy. Okay, so you need not rerun. Okay, you need not re-enter all the details if you have saved your search strategy. Okay. So the databases, of course, they will ask you to create an account. Okay, so in this personal account, you can save the copy of your search strategy, right? So we have seen the last step, saving your search strategy. And coming to this next one, so you have done your searching some few months back and still you are writing, and definitely there will be lots of updates. Okay, so you need to definitely stay up to date with database alerts. This is one of the ways to stay up to date. Okay, so many databases will have auto alerts. Okay, they will send you alerts if a new article is published on your search topic. Okay, so you can keep that. And there are lots of other ways also to keep yourself up to date on the topic of your research. Okay, so I will give you a link afterwards. I will share this in the chat box so you can understand what are the different ways. Okay, you can connect with professional networks like LinkedIn, ResearchGate, Mendeley. Okay, you can create a profile. You can collaborate with the other researchers who are working in the same topic or same field and all. So you can stay up to date. Okay, so this I will share it with you later. Right. So with this, I would like to conclude this search and research topic with my favorite quote by Alfred Lord Tennyson: to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield. Okay, this fits more appropriately, okay, to this topic, searching, okay, as part of your research. I would like to reiterate that if you understand the nuances of the research, okay, the searching process will not be an arduous task. It will definitely be a joyful learning experience. I can assure you that you will come across a lot more ideas, concepts on the topic, on your chosen topic. Definitely it will give you, it will strengthen your domain knowledge, domain specific knowledge, and your vertical knowledge will be steeper, right? And not only that, it will give you some unplanned advantages. I would call it as a beneficial side effects, right, of meticulous searching. It will expedite your research process because you have laid a strong foundation by narrowing down your title, your research topic. For that only it will take a lot of time. Okay, and then you also have enough materials for your chapter literature review. Right, so you have a strong foundation. You have arrived at it is half done. Your research is half done if you have a strong search strategy, okay, and strong literature searching. Then it is very easy for you to build up your research. Okay, so definitely it is worth investing your time in searching in relevant databases. This investment definitely will yield you rich benefits. Okay, so with these few words, I would like to end my session wishing you happy searching and research.